Poetry as spellcasting. Poems, essays, and prompts for manifesting liberation and reclaiming power. By Tamiko Beyer, Destiny Hemphill, and Lisbeth White. Narrated by Henriette Zoutomou. Published by North Atlantic Books. Excerpted material from the print version of this book can be found in the PDF that comes with this audiobook. 1. Opening the Circle. Awakening of Stones. Hypothesis/Central Argument by Lisbeth White. In the new mythology, you are always whole. If and when you fracture, it is not a part. A part does not exist here. You will know that upon entry. You will know each fissure as it breaks open your life. You will know the cracked edges of your splendor. You will know the steady tear and repair of your muscles. It is true. The heart is broken less by pain, more often by the beauty we fear we cannot offer. You are born knowing how to make the sounds of your heart. You are born knowing how to make your hands into wings. How We Got Our Blues Tongue by Destiny Hemphill. After the Commodores and Tremaine Hawkins, and with a line from Tony Cade Bambara, and the augurs among us direct our gaze to the sky, all alluvial, breaking through, breaking blue, and we open our mouths to catch the cerulean, catch the rugged blues again on our tongue, blurred and bruised. Decadent deluge of dirge-drenching skin, dandelions, and dirt. Diviners say we dance in dizzy to the ends of the world, dancing at the end of the world, to elsewhere, edging to flight. Let there be flight, and there flight be. We be a many-forked tongue folk, glossolalia gurgling, crossing and translating other realms folk. Apocalyptic glitch. We put our hands on our hips, then put our hands in the air, hold our hands to the haints, and catch their iridescent feathers. Oh, haints, come true to us. Come blue to us. Come through to this juke joint we call Earth, this jagged jollification. We won't jilt you. No, we keep our dead kin with us, as the dead kin have kept us, the living. Listen, empire can't catch us, but it can catch these hands of redistribution, these moonfire spells to undo and redo, these fractal-winged myths exploding the means, this newness, this emergence, that isn't actually that new at all. If we tell them the truth about our origins, this is quite old. Blues old, which is bones old, which is dirt old. Oh yes, we've got our poems, parables, psalms, and our own palms as record that we've refashioned ourselves before. We've questioned ourselves before. Quivered with loss before. Made portal of crisis and quantum leap. Rebirthed. Bled and tended flesh wounds with rest and stinging medicine before. Because the material without the spiritual and psychic does not a dialectic make. Let's get the rhythm of our feet. Let's get the rhythm of our throats. Holding a cosmic alchemy of tragedy and celebration that can turn this thing upside down. So that the sky becomes soil, and soil becomes sky. And dirt is what we seek for salvation. Verily, verily, when you get this rhythm, meet us at the crossroads. You'll know because you'll hear whistling from the mulberry trees. You'll smell them too. And we'll be there, perched, looking real xenial and otherworldly. We'll be humming with the Haints, conspiring about going up yonder. Going up yonder to be with our mother world. Zoom, zoom. We'd like to fly away. Fly away to right here. February by Tamiko Beyer. I'm climbing out of this season, fingernails ragged, belly soft. I tuck a stem of dried mint behind my ear to remind myself. Once, I bared my shoulders. The bottom of my feet roughed up the dirt with calluses. When I harvested arugula, it smelled of green. All chemical veins pulsing sun and dirt and water. I do remember this. I pinned summer light up in my hair and made no apologies for the space I took up. Barely clothed and sunbound. Now a ball of twine in the gray sky. The sun rolls low on the horizon, hangs, then dips back down again, wind howling us into night. Inside the erratic rhythm of this wavering flame, I conjure the potent sky of the longest day. Seeds with a whole galaxy inside. Cicadas vibrating in alders. But the sensation of joy slips too quickly into simulacra. Song on repeat. I never meant to find myself in such a cold place, my hair thinning against winter. Once, red clover grew thick where today's rabbit tracks patterned the snow. Clover said flow. Clover said nourish. Clover said, we've got this. I reel the memory out, let it linger on the horizon, then reel it back in. I play it out and reel it back in. Some kind of fishing, some kind of flying. Again and again. I loosen the buckles of my mind. I take up space in the precision of my breath. I call us all back in. Introduction. In 2018, the Supreme Court upheld the 45th president's Muslim ban in Trump versus Hawaii. At the same time, it overruled the 1944 decision that justified the imprisonment of more than 120,000 Japanese and Japanese American people during World War II. Poet Kenji C. Liu put out a call for spells that responded to this judicial sleight of hand, as he phrased it, and to the imprisonment of thousands of children and families by ICE. He gathered 14 poem spells written by poets of color in a folio for the online journal, Unmargin. In his introduction, he wrote, "In addition to protesting, building complex communities of resistance and vision, and self-care practices, writers also have language, one of the original magics. We too can summon our own enchantments, incantations, protections, charms, curses, hexes, blessings, auguries, banishments, and more." These words planted a seed in Tamiko Beyer's mind, which sprouted into a panel on poetry of spellcasting, offered at the 2019 and Now conference at the University of Washington, Bothell. Beyer, Destiny Hemphill, Lisbeth White, and Tatiana Figueroa Ramirez. All of us poets with a variety of relationships to and experiences with ritual and spellcasting, led a writing ritual. It ended with the 24 or so participants standing in a circle, casting a collective spell for liberation and transformation. We felt the energy swirl between us, through the room, and out to where we were sending our intentions. An ICE detention center several miles away. In that place, in that moment, the concept of poetry as spellcasting blossomed from a seedling into a lush and powerful being unto itself. A different configuration of poet spellcasters. Beyer, Figueroa, Ramirez, Liu, and Sun Yung-shin prepared and led a similar panel at the annual Writers' Conference known as AWP in March 2020. in the last packed room that many of us would step into for the next 2 years. We cast another powerful collective spell for liberation and transformation. Shortly after, we were invited by North Atlantic Books to turn our thinking and spellcasting into book form. Over the next 2 years, editors Beyer, Hemphill, and White dreamed into poetry as spellcasting. We reached out to our networks, we edited, and we wrote. We moved at the pace of life, bringing this book into being in the midst of a global pandemic, uprisings for racial justice, mass shootings, an attempted coup, a sharpening climate crisis, economic precarity, personal crises, travels, and disruptions. We met over video conference, often on full and new moons, connecting across the country to work, laugh, rage, write, puzzle through challenges, and honor the unnameable mystery of poetry as spellcasting. And finally, here we are. This book in itself is a spell, a sea serpent, a seedling grown to a fruit-bearing tree. It is the result of a deeply collaborative process between the three of us, in which we also asked for and received contributions and energies from a whole web of other writers. Together, we co-wrote sections, and we also contributed essays and poems individually. The result is part anthology, part poetry collection, part workbook. We asked just a few of our friends and writers we admired to contribute specific essays on poetry as spellcasting, based on what we knew of their work. We were delighted and surprised by the direction they went with the topic. We wove these essays, along with prompts and poems by us and others, to create a body of work that we hope will be accessible in many different ways. There were many more writers and witches we would have loved to include if we had unlimited time and space. And we hope this book might plant a seed, the way Lou's folio did, for other manifestations of poetry as spellcasting. The three of us identify variously as Black, multiracial, Asian American, disabled, queer, and femme. We wrote and edited this book as a love poem and spell by and for poets of color, spellmakers, magic makers. We conceived of the book as queer, bringing a queer investigation into our practices. For us, poetry and ritual are not separate from the larger political landscape in which we live, write, and cast spells. Indeed, language has the power to both reflect and manifest our shared perceptions of reality and the world in which we live. Human language is transmitted socially, yet the words we speak and write begin in the most intimate and most uniquely creative corners of our psyches. What we think and believe lives in internal language before, and regardless of whether, we utter a word. We know that it benefits systems that wish to stay in power to control our access to certain languages as soon as possible. Imperialistic, human-centric, colonial, racist, cis-sexist, heteronormative, consumer capitalist, patriarchal, ableist. These are all types of language that are embedded in educational systems, workplaces, religious settings, and even homes, aimed to constrict the ways we name and understand the world as we know it. And yet, while human language, like any human construction, is susceptible to institutional and cultural capture and violence, there is something about language that is serpent-like, fluid, potent, capable of slipping through tight spaces and recreating itself like new skin. Here is where poetry and spellcasting converge. Even as scholarship and discipline hone skillful application of both, poetry and the magical arts have long been practices of the people. Like nearly all arts, they arose organically in human life, accessible to any and all seeking to explore relationships to such practices, despite attempts to colonize and isolate this access. Most practitioners of poetry, ritual, or any creative endeavor will express moments of opening or surrender to an energy that feels beyond the personal ego, a something mighty and unnamed, as both poetry and spellcasting exist and play in the spaces closest to this mystery.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.